In the final part of this six-part series called The Promises of God, inspired by Psalm 119, verses 161 to 176, Pastor David Wise challenges us about always telling the truth, and there are encouraging testimonies about how God's Word can bring peace and stability into our lives. As this teaching was delivered on Bible Sunday, Pastor David concludes with looking at the importance of all the Bible being in our lives, and members of the congregation talk about how this works for them.
Okay, we have been looking over a number of weeks at Psalm 119, and we come to the final section of that today. Just to remind you, there may be some of you who are here for the first time in this teaching, just to remind you about Psalm 119. The Psalms are all poetry that was originally sung, and different Psalms are of different types and of different structures. And it's really important to understand the structure of each Psalm as we understand the Psalm itself. Now, Psalm 119, as you've heard me say before, is the longest of the Psalms. It has 176 verses. So by a long way, it's the longest of the Psalms. It has a very, very formal structure. The Psalms were originally written in Hebrew, most of the Old Testament, not all of it. Most of it was originally written in Hebrew. The Hebrew alphabet has 22 letters. And the Psalm is grouped. Each section of eight verses begins with a different letter from the Hebrew alphabet. If you're looking in the New International Version, you'll see that there are these headings with the Hebrew letter, the picture of what the letter looks like, and then an English pronunciation for each of those letters. So what's 8 22s? I'd already told you the answer. Okay, the 22 letters, eight verses with each letter. I told you there are 176 verses, so 8 22s are?
176.
Fantastic! You're learning your 22 times table. That's very, very impressive. Next week, we'll probably ask you what 9 22s are, just to keep up the... I'm teasing. But there are other things about this psalm as well. Almost every verse in the psalm contains one of the eight theme words from the psalm. Those eight theme words are the word law, decrees, statutes, commandments, ordinances, word, precepts, and promise. So you've got a chunk of eight verses, each beginning with the same letter, and then you've got eight key words. You begin to see how this psalm is a very complex structure. It's a really impressive piece of literature. I mean, it's a wonderful piece of literature. But more importantly, as I've said each time, it is a very important part of God's word. And as we've seen, the teaching of this psalm runs counter to lots of stuff in current culture, and I'm going to be touching on more of that as we do the last part of this psalm today. Now, we don't know who wrote this psalm. We can learn from its contents a few things, and these are tentative, but we think that perhaps the writer was a young man. We think that he was someone who was under pressure, both from those in authority, the people he calls the princes or the rulers, and also from his peers, from those around him. And he was under pressure, not because he was a bad person. He was under pressure, actually, because he was a good person. He was a person who was trying to serve God. And that is why the pressure came. So, that's it for the PowerPoint. Let's begin verse 161, and we're going to look at 161 to 168 first of all, and I've called this section Peace in Conflict. Peace in Conflict. So this section begins, rulers persecute me without cause, But my heart trembles at your words. I rejoice in your promise, like one who finds great spoil. Now, all of us in life face difficult situations, don't we, from time to time? I mean, some of you today may be facing, well, I know some of you are facing today, really difficult situations. And this writer here, he's facing a difficult situation. In his context, the rulers are persecuting him without cause. Now, if those in authority were persecuting you, your heart might have fear, might tremble because of those in authority. Is that a fair comment? Yeah? But his heart doesn't. His heart, what he's feeling, what he is experiencing, what he's thinking, is determined not by the action of the rulers, but by God's word. And it's a very big distinction. I wonder, I don't want you to answer this question. Sometimes I'm going to ask you questions and I want you to answer. But this one, just to keep the answer to yourself. I wonder, when difficulties come, when really hard things come your way, what determines your response? Is it what's going on the outside? Is it the relative, the friend, the work situation, the person that's giving you a really hard time? Is that what determines your response, what you feel? Or is it determined by the inside, by God's word, by God's presence? To use a different picture, a different metaphor, you know, sometimes for us in life, outside, it can get really stormy. My wife was supposed to today be traveling to the States for a meeting. It's been cancelled because there's a huge storm. What was it, 900 miles across, this storm that's in the States at the moment? So the meeting's been postponed. Now, storms come our way in life. But on the inside, we should have God's Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen? We should have God's presence. And on the inside, we should have God's word that is there on the inside. So when it's stormy on the outside, is how we are determined by the storm on the outside or God's peace on the inside? The sun shining on the inside, the wind and rain are there on the outside, which determines how we are. For this writer, and I think what should be normal for us, is what is there on the inside that determines our response, not what's going on the outside. So when that person this week turns to you and says something really nasty to you, which you don't deserve, what determines your response? That nasty word on the outside or God's peace on the inside? When you get that email this week that has got a threat in it for you, what determines your response? Fear because of that email, or God's word on the inside? What determines your response? We should have God's word, God's spirit, so strongly on the inside that it determines how we relate to, how we respond to what's going on the outside. That should be determinative for us. Rulers persecute me without cause, but my heart trembles at your word, God. And I rejoice in your promise, like one who finds great spoil. That word spoil is a very specific word. It's not a word that we actually use in English because it doesn't really apply in our context. Spoil is the specific word for treasure that's obtained after a battle. So, great big battle, two armies, big fight. The army in the red corner lose, the army in the blue corner win, the army in the blue corner take all the treasure, all the spoil from the army in the red corner. And that word spoil is what's used in that context. It's the trophies of war. And it was valued very, very highly. It was valued highly, not just because of its worth, but because we, the Blue Army, we've won it. We've got it. So it was extra special. You know, when you've, I don't know, you might have some trophy in your house. I don't know, on your mantelpiece. You might have a cupboard with trophies. I'm trying to think, when in someone's house, they've got a whole cabinet full of trophies that they've won in sporting events. Don't remember who it was for the moment, but there we go. If you've got a trophy and you have worked really, really hard for it, and you know it's a culmination of years of work and effort, and you've been awarded this trophy, that's a lot more valuable than if you were, I don't know, down the pub last week at a pub quiz and part of a team, and they gave you a little trophy. The value of the trophy is according to the work and effort you put in, which is why spoil here is such a strong word. And he says, I rejoice in your promise, in God's word, like one who finds great spoil. That's how valuable God's word is. That's why today, on this Bible Sunday, we are encouraging you to get more into God's word. And I'm going to be talking more about that towards the end of the teaching this morning, because this is wonderful treasure. Let's go on. Verse 163. I hate and abhor falsehood, but I love your law. 7 times a day I praise you for your righteous laws. Great peace have they who love your law. John 8:44 describes Satan as the father of lies and all that is false. You know, as a pastor, I never cease to be amazed. Some of you will know I've been a pastor a long time. I've been here 25 years and I pastored 2 churches before I came here. Not for 25 years each, I hasten to add. I am old, but not quite that old. I never cease to be amazed at the way that some Christians, and I'm not thinking of anybody who's part of the church here at this point in time. So if you've seen me recently and think that I'm talking about a conversation I've had with you, I'm not. This is a general principle. So I never cease to be amazed at the way that some Christians think it's okay for them to lie. Even dressing it up as though somehow it's a good thing because it's a white lie. As though that means that somehow it's not a lie because it's a white lie. The clue is in the word lie. You call it what colour you like. But the clue is in the noun, not the description of the colour. And Satan is the father of lies and all that is false. So here you have this really strong statement from the writer. I love your law, but I hate and abhor, which is detest. It's a really strong emotional word, falsehood. It's a challenge for us. And we live in a society where lying is considered to be quite acceptable and normal. I remember in my last church, we had a guy converted. And he'd become a Christian, invited Jesus into his life. And he was on a discipleship program that we ran there, which I was leading. And we were talking about in different weeks how, you know, now we've become Christians, how our lives need to be more and more reflective of God's standards. And we came upon this week, we were talking about truthfulness. And I was saying things along the lines you've heard me say now. And he said to me, Pastor, he said, I can't do that. I said, what do you mean you can't do that? He said, it's my job. I am paid to lie. I am paid to deceive the public. That is what I'm paid for. I won't tell you what he did. He wasn't a politician, before you jump to any conclusions. But he had a very senior position. He said, I am paid to lie. I am paid to stand up in front of the media and say stuff that's not true. That's my job. That was the last time we saw him at church. Because he made the decision that actually being a Christian and doing his job was incompatible. And he made the wrong decision to walk away from God and continue with his job, because he was very well paid for lying. So, you know, that was 28, 29, maybe 30 years ago. And we think that lying in our society is something new. But it's so much just what is normal in our society here. But for us, it's not. That's why Scripture says that we shouldn't swear oaths. The reason we shouldn't swear oaths is because our word should be good enough. We shouldn't have to make some big oath to back up what we're saying, because our word ought to be good enough. We should be trusted that if we're speaking, it's true. It's gone very quiet. Runs counter to society, but God's word, God's law, runs counter to so much. We should be having the same attitude as the writer here, hating all falsehood. And then he says, seven times a day I praise you. I was quite amused reading the commentators this week, because they're all debating, they're debating about this. Does it mean that he literally seven times every day? Or does it mean that seven is a symbol of completeness and perfection, because in the Bible, seven is a symbolic number? He was only required under the law at that time to pray this number of times a day. He was doing more than that. Or is it just meaning, just a symbol that it... Anyway, forget all of that. What's most important is he spent a lot of time praising God. Out of response to what God was saying to him, out of response to his word. It was just a daily part of his life, praising and worshipping God. And one of the consequences of God's word in his life, it's in verse 165. There are two things there. There is great peace and not stumbling. Stability, if you like. So here's my first question for you to answer this morning. And it's for you to have a think for a moment about your own life. And most of you here are people who read God's word. You're people who... many of you have been reading God's word for years. So I want you to think about if there are some examples in your own life where God's word from Scripture, God's word, has enabled you in a situation of difficulty to know peace, or in a time of instability to know stability and not stumbling because of God's word. Got the question? So it's like a testimony question, but it's just to try and help us understand how this works in practice. Because you read it here on the paper and great. What does it actually look like in people's lives? So I wonder if some might like to give some examples of that.
A few years ago when I wasn't retired, I was working, and not knowing what to do because there was a great big reorganization, long story, I think most people know about it. And then my mind was going round and round, what should I do? Thinking, analyzing the situation, thinking if I go this way, that way, and the other way. And the word of the Lord really, which said, trust in the Lord and lean not unto your own understanding. And that's the word, your own understanding, leaning on that. It really gave me peace, because if you trust God, don't think too much about it. And then things worked out, and things did work out very well for me.
Thank you very much. Great example. Anybody else?
For me, it's for forgiving somebody that's done something really bad. I just remember the verse says, we do not war against flesh and blood, but against powers, you know, in the invisible realm. So I just was able to release that person. At the same time, I released myself because I can forgive them and stop beating myself up, you know, sinning, you know, like that.
Fantastic, thank you. So there is, in a relational situation, a peace that's brought. Any others?
For me, it was when I was expecting my daughter, and normally during the antenatal classes, I had my in my notebook what's going to happen, like having a pool bed and all the rest. I have everything sorted, but day she was due, nothing was happening, and they tried to break my water and everything. Nothing still was happening, and the nurses were getting worried and saying, in their 35 years of nursing, this has never happened to them. I asked them not to worry, and they said we're going to end up having CS. So I said, okay. He said, it's only going to take 20 minutes. And as soon as we got to the tertiary room, and everything that could go wrong went wrong. And I was saying to the Lord, I trust you. Even though the doctors were all saying, call this person, call that person, print this out of the internet. And I said, Lord, I do trust you in all this. Even though people are panicking, I know this child is going to come out alive, and I'm going to come out alive as well. So God's word actually was firm in my heart. The things around me wasn't looking great, but deep in my heart, I knew he promised and it was going to come true. Yeah.
Right, thank you. Excellent.
There's been many times in our past when my husband was out of work, as quite a few people here will know, and obviously money was really tight. And during that time, we had peace. We knew that God would never leave us or forsake us, and he did look after us. There was one particular time, I think we got down to our last penny, and something happened, and he looked after us.
Great, thank you very much. Okay, one last, just waiting till I get to the front. You just need to give me the exercise, don't you?
Sorry, just being a bit difficult. I just have a testimony about a friend who had difficulties in her studies, and she ended up losing her place at medical school. And everything was saying, this is impossible, she's not going to get taken back in. But then I remember one day when I was like getting dressed to go to theatre, and she told me that she had an interview or a panel discussion at university, and normally they just say, we're really sorry, we're going to go. But then I just thought, no, I need to just get every single Christian person I know just to pray for her at this time. So I text everyone, like, we have to pray, like, now. And God is so good, because she was allowed back in, and with the policy, normally they would not allow any student in her situation back in. And now she's even come to church with me at times when I'm at university, and her mum even said, it's because of God. Like, this is why, like, it's a supernatural thing. Like, your God has let this happen. So it's been a testimony for her. So,
thank you. It's the power of God's word in our own lives to transform our response, and in our circumstance and relationships to transform those. Okay, verse 166. I wait for your salvation, O Lord. I follow your commands. I obey your statutes, for I love them greatly. I obey your precepts and your statutes, for all my ways are known to you. We can hide nothing from God. God knows absolutely everything there is to know about us. I've quoted another speaker on occasions to say, God never gets disillusioned with us, because God never had any illusions about us in the first place. Because he knows you. He knows me. He knows us inside and out. Every single thing that there is to know, every little detail, God knows. And in the context of here, there are all sorts of implications from that, but in the context of here, it means that this writer was determined to be obedient to all of God's word. I came across quite a clever quote this week. I'll read it a couple of times. just so you get this. It's a guy called Williams, who I've quoted a number of times from this psalm. He wrote this. Listen to this carefully. Sin will keep you from God's word, or God's word will keep you from sin. Do you like that? Sin will keep you from God's word, or God's word will keep you from sin. If we have God's word in our life, it keeps us from sin. Amen. Let's look at these final section, verse 166 down to verse, 169 down to verse 176. May my cry come before you, O Lord. Give me understanding according to your word. May my supplication come before you. Deliver me according to your promise. May my lips overflow with praise for you to teach me your decrees. May my tongue sing of your word, for all your commands are righteous. May your hand be ready to help me, for I have chosen your precepts. This final section that we're looking at, I've called it, Your Law is My Delight. Your Law is My Delight. And it recaps some of the themes that we've been looking at earlier in the psalm. The request here, as they have been on a number of occasions previously, for God's understanding and for deliverance. And the writer's response to God's word again here is obedience and worship. The last three verses. I long for your salvation, O God. Your law is my delight. Let me live that I may praise you, and may your laws sustain me. I have strayed like a lost sheep. Seek your servant, for I have not forgotten your commands. Verse 175 has got an interesting implication that the purpose of life is for us to praise God. And that's not just about singing songs. We do praise God when we're singing songs, but actually this is about the way we live our life. It says, doesn't it, in Romans, about presenting our bodies as a living sacrifice. This is acceptable worship to God. So it's about the whole of our lives. Well, my last question on the psalm, and then we're going to briefly look at a couple of verses in the New Testament, reflecting that it's Bible Sunday today. My last question on this psalm, as you look at this section here, which, as I say, got many of the themes from the earlier parts of the psalm, are there any reflections, any things that you look at that and you feel, either from those verses or thinking back earlier into the psalm, things that you think are particularly significant for you or for us to take hold of? So, reflective question. Looking at this last section, is there anything in there that maybe reflects something from earlier in the psalm? Or maybe just out of these verses that you think is particularly significant for you or for us. Have a think about that for a moment.
He's asking, and he asks in other places about, may God do this, may my lips overflow with praise, may my tongue sing of your word. We can't even do this on our own. It's totally dependent on God. So even praising him has to start with him, and the whole thing has to start with God. It's amazing.
Thank you.
I think it's encouraging, even sort of at the end of this psalm, that, the psalmist writes, I have strayed like a lost sheep. seek your servant, whereas, you know, not long before he was saying, I love your precepts and I obey you. But I think the key of it is, you know, in the word strayed, it's not like we, as Christians, we sort of, right, say that's it, and we walk the opposite direction. Straight, it's like a gradual, just a slipping thing, and it's very subtle. But, yeah, but God is always there in all of that, and he welcomes us back.
As we saw earlier in the meeting this morning with that testimony earlier on. Thank you.
I was thinking about where it says, may my tongue sing of your word. And I struggle to read, but I do find that a lot of songs that we sing, when they've got the word of God in them, are really helpful, because they help you to, when you're in times of difficulty, it reminds you, and you can bring them forward, and they help you out. So I think that was quite important to know that it's, although we should still read the Bible, but, you know, sometimes singing the word of God really helps us to remember later on in life, or a time when we've got a crisis, that we can remember a song, and that will bring us back to the word of God as well.
I agree with you totally. I think that we remember often, for some people, remember scripture so much better because we've sung it. And our thinking can be shaped. It takes it deep inside us in a way that sometimes what we're reading doesn't do. Any final comment?
Yeah, in verse 171, where it says, may my lips overflow with praise, that's so easy for me to do. As you know, I have a young family and we travel everywhere by bus. So if you want to know about how the world is, have a young child in a pushchair on a bus, and you could learn about selflessness or selfishness. And, you know, we get it quite often, Louise and I. We have learnt peace. You know when you pray for peace, God doesn't say, here, Wayne, here, Pastor David, have some peace. He puts you in situations so you can learn about yourself and how to deal with peace. And we learn about peace on the buses, would you believe? So just this week alone, you know, my wife and I and the baby got on a bus. We had an appointment at Oxbridge, and there was a lady sitting in the seats, which are allocated to people who have babies or are disabled or pensioners. And we politely said, would you please move to the back so Louise could sit with the baby? She said no. So I learned peace. And I actually have to say out loud, this is why I have Jesus in my life. Because if I was of the world without Jesus, I would lift her up and say, have a seat. So it's easy for me to praise Jesus, because without Jesus, I have no peace.
And if those of you that know Wayne's background and history would know that lifting people up on the bus is, it wouldn't be the first time he's done something like that. Okay, let's move on. Would you turn, please, to 2 Timothy chapter 3?
I've got two quotes to finish this section on Psalm 119, which will lead us into the next bit that we're going to look at this morning. Spurgeon, writing on Psalm 119, summing up at the end, he says this: the entire Bible is a wellspring of consolation and enjoyment to all who receive it. I like that. The entire Bible brings consolation and enjoyment to all who receive it. And Williams, my final quote from Williams: the importance of God's word cannot be stressed enough. It reveals the very nature of God. And we've been marking today the fact that this here in the UK is Bible Sunday. And I want to finish this morning just by looking at four verses from 2 Timothy chapter 3. We're going to just look at verses 14 down to verse 17. which is a New Testament passage about the Bible, and just make some observations out of that. Because one of the themes of Psalm 119 has been about God's word and getting God's word inside of us and following God's word. And I just want to explore that a little bit more. So, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14 and 15. As for you, this is Timothy receiving this letter, continue in what you've learned and have become convinced of, because you know from whom you learnt it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Some people looking at these verses have highlighted four disciplines by which people can take in what the Bible teaches. Four different things. So the first of them in verse 15 is about knowing and becoming acquainted with the Bible. Now, the only way that you know and become acquainted with the Bible is because you listen to it or you read it. It actually has to come into you. Now, having it on your shelf at home may stop things falling over, but it won't get the Bible inside of you. It may be in your house, but it won't be in your life. Does your Bible need dusting? Just an interesting question. Does your Bible need dusting? No. Do you know where it is? Yes. I've been in one or two people's houses. And again, this is not, I can't remember anybody specific at this point in time. So, you know, and I wanted to read something from the Bible. Have you got a, can I read something from your Bible? Oh, Pastor, I'm not quite sure where it is. So they disappear off and there's rummaging and banging and all sorts of things. And, here it is, Pastor. Now, if you don't take it in, if you don't listen to it, and I know some people, or don't read it, some people are not great readers. And I understand that. These days, you don't have to read. You can listen. You can download the whole of the Bible for free from the internet. Listen to it on your MP3 player, whatever one of those is. I haven't got one, but I understand it's something you can listen to the Bible on. Or on your laptop or whatever else. Or you can buy it on CD. But you've got to take it in. The second thing is learning it. How do you know when you've learnt something? Let me just pick on somebody. Warren, how do you know? It's great being an assistant pastor, isn't it? Wonderful.
Yes.
How do you know when you have learnt something?
Because it gets stuck in your head and you apply it to your life.
That's half the answer.
Yes.
And the other half is? Anybody want to help him? See, you know you've learnt something when you can teach it to somebody else. You were nearly there. You're on there. It changes your... Yeah, if it's obvious, why didn't you say it? He's lovely, isn't he? You know, if you've got some skill, you know, whatever job you do or at home, if you can teach that to somebody else, you've learnt it. Yeah? But it's a step beyond just being familiar and being acquainted with something. Because you learn it by studying it, giving time and attention, and maybe listening to other people or being shown by other people who are experts. I, years ago, used to do all my own car maintenance. Back in the days when you didn't need to have a big computer. When you didn't need a big computer before you opened the bonnet, you know, when everything you could fix with a spanner and a screwdriver. Is there a problem with that?
Sure. Your own car, mate. Sorry. Look at him. Unless you suggested there
might be. Now, I am no great mechanic, But people used to come and show me what to do. People who actually knew, really knew what they were doing. So when I had to take the engine apart or other bits that I did on various occasions, I had someone that really, really knew what they were doing, used to come and help. I'm having trouble with you this morning. The point is, once I'd learned how to do it, I could actually occasionally even show somebody else how to do something. And then I know that I'd learned it. Now, I could put the Haynes manual away and actually show somebody else. That's how you know you've learned it. And we need to be doing that with Scripture. So knowing it, learning it, being convinced of its truth. You know, you can know something, you can rehearse it, you can even explain it to somebody else without believing it's true. Ask a double glazing salesman or a used car salesman. Ex-used car salesman. But we need to be convinced of its truth. We need to know it's true. And the fourth thing is that we continue always, verse 14, in our learning. Now, all of us need to do that. I have been reading the Bible almost every day now for 43 years. I have a degree in theology. I have a master's in biblical interpretation. I am still learning about the Bible. We never know it all. If we think we know it all, we're in trouble. We never know it all. And I still see, when I read the Bible, I still see fresh things. We need to be always learning, lifelong learning, in terms of how we handle Scripture and allow Scripture to handle us. Because, verse 16, all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. All Scripture is God-breathed. It's why the Bible is so important to us, because it's inspired by and giving life by the living God. It's a living book, not a dead historic document. We need to allow God's life to come into us. You know, we're surrounded by all sorts of voices and values. You know, you pick up any newspaper, any magazine, you read something on the internet, and there will be advice about how you should do things, how you should live your life, how you should be in this situation. And you're surrounded by friends who will offer you advice. Not all of that is terribly helpful. We have all those voices around us, all sorts of value systems. And in the middle of all of that, this is what we need to rely on. God's word. God's word. It's essential we allow the Bible to guide us. There are five key reasons, five key things that the Bible helps us with. The Bible puts us right about what God is like. Now, I remember I was rehearsing in conversation yesterday. I was doing some of you will know I'm a tutor on a master's course, and I was a day with students yesterday. I was rehearsing a conversation I'd had with a church leader who doesn't believe that God is going to punish anybody. He believes that everybody is going to heaven. He believes that God's love is so powerful that everyone will, my word, not his, be forced to accept God's love. Now, when I read the Bible, I'm afraid that doesn't look to be true to me, because we have a God of love, but we also have a God of righteous judgment. But for him, in his approach to the Bible, those bits that don't fit in with what he thinks, he says, oh, those are just for a past age. We don't need to take too much notice of that. which is rather sad, really, because he's missing out on an awful lot. The Bible puts us right about what God is like. The Bible leads us to the real Jesus, not Jesus of fiction or Jesus of fantasy. The Bible sets us right on the facts of our faith, what it is that we really believe. The Bible helps us sort out what is right from what is wrong. We're bombarded, aren't we, with all sorts of things. Let's pick a couple of random things. Money. And we've got all this stuff at us about what we should do, how we should handle money. The Bible's very clear that we are stewards of money. God gives stuff to us for us to steward. We don't own it. It's God's. And that affects what we do with it, how we handle it, what we use it for. We are stewards. Just one of the things that's there in the Bible about money. Sex and sexuality would be another. The Bible's very clear. Sex is a good thing inside marriage. Everywhere else, it's not a helpful or good thing. Very clear. Bible tells us about that. Bible puts us right on all those sorts of issues. The Bible equips us for action. Got this great quote. God's word equips God's people to do God's work. Now, any job you start to do these days, there is always a training course. I mean, it may only be 10 minutes, or it might be 2 weeks, or it might be... How long's your training course, you one day? 6 years. That's a long training course. So there's a training course that equips you to do the task. We are all called to be working with God, aren't we? And part of that training course is here, that helps us to be effective in serving God. God's word equips God's people to do God's work. How much of Scripture is God breathed? How much? Warren, what's your favourite food?
A burger.
There you go. Okay. I actually should bring the microphone over here for this conversation. So your favourite food is burger?
Yeah. If all you ever ate was burger, do you think you would be healthy?
No.
What would happen to your general sense of well-being if all you ever bet was burger?
Become very flabby and unfit and able to move and not function properly, have a very wrong skin complexion, and generally just would not look good but would look very flabby.
Okay. We've all got our favourite bits of scripture, haven't we? I could go around now and ask you what your favourite bit of scripture is, and you would instantly tell me what your favourite bit of scripture is. Joan, what's your favourite bit of scripture? Quick.
John 14. Romans 10 and 9.
There you go. We could go around and do all of that. But if the only thing that you ever read is your favourite bit of scripture, just imagine Warren on a diet of just burgers. We need all of scripture. Just eating our favourite foods, it's very nice, but it doesn't make us healthy. We need a balanced diet. All of God's word is necessary for us to get hold of. And there are all sorts of different ways that we can feed on the Bible. I encourage people to read the Bible every day. Now, that doesn't mean you read your favourite psalm every day. I did say to somebody once, I remember this conversation, I apologise if you're in the room, I don't remember who you were. Do you read the Bible very often? Yeah, I read it every day. How do you choose what to read? Oh, it's very easy, Pastor, I just read the same passage. Okay, that's good, but I think that, you know, we've got the Warren Burger mentality here. We need to be taking on all of Scripture, which is why we're today promoting a number of different ways of reading. I've used a whole range over the year. Bible reading notes, group called Scripture Union produce fantastic Bible reading notes. They're at different levels. And over a course of 4 years or 7 years, depending which course you're using, you will go through all the key parts of the Bible with some notes from someone that really understands it to help you understand. Fantastic. I did that for years. It's what put the foundation in for me, for my understanding of Scripture. But also reading the Bible through in a year. I've done that a number of times. There was a period, I think, of 4 years where every year I started at the beginning using a reading program. If you start at Genesis and you read four chapters a day, when you get to the book of Numbers and Leviticus, you may get slightly bogged down. So the way to do it is that you read, and you can download this from the internet, or if you can't find it, ask Warren, he'll point you to it. You read a bit from the Old Testament, starting with Genesis, a psalm, and a bit from the New Testament every day. In a year, about 15 minutes a day for the average reader, you can read the whole of the Bible from end to end. Really encourage you. If you've never done that, I encourage you to do it. And to do it maybe in a translation that might be not the one you bring to church, might be a translation like the Message, or a translation that is easy to read and to take in. But studying as well. Studying a book from the Bible. I mean, you enjoy coming along when I'm teaching because we study together. And we've spent 5 hours together looking at Psalm 119. And because we've been studying it, you've got a lot more out of it than if you just listened to it or read it through quickly. On the bookstore, you'll find a number of books that will help you study different books from the Bible. If you need advice, ask Warren or one of the others of us. We can point you in some directions to take hold of stuff, to help you learn. Discussing in meeting together groups, most of you here are in meeting together groups. If you're not in a meeting together group, it's a group of three, typically, sometimes slightly more people, who part of the church here, who agree to meet together at least once a fortnight for at least an hour to pray together and read the Bible together. And there's talking and sharing that can come out of that. You can help one another in your understanding of the Bible. There's something called Word Live, which we promote as well. Warren, come and join me. Tell us about Word Live, because you use it.
I do. Word Live, it's free. It's on the internet. You go to www.wordlive.org. It's run by Scripture Union. You log on for free. You register for free. Let's get that right. And every day you get an email to your chosen email address. And on there will be an opening sort of prayer, word of verse from the Bible. There will then be pictures, a nice picture to help you meditate and think on. And then there will be a whole passage of scripture. And then there will be some information about how to unpack, you know, what that meant, give you a bit of more background information. There's even deeper study now in there that goes even further. So you get some more historical or cultural background behind the Bible. And there's a response time. There is also right at the bottom is this reading the Bible in a year, give you the passages for that day to read in a year. But it gets emailed to you free of charge every day. It inspires you to read.
And that could obviously be to your smartphone, whatever one of those is, wherever it is. There are these fantastic resources around, and we want to promote them, encourage. So after we have finished in a few minutes' time, you might want to go and have a look at the bookstore, see if there's stuff there that you can help. But think about how it's going to be for you to get God's word more and more into your life. Let's stand together. I'm going to give you a moment to make your own response to God. There may be something you want to say to God at this point in time, some promise you want to make to God, something you want to commit to Him, and then I'm going to pray for us as we come to a conclusion of our meeting this afternoon. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your living word that is here for us. Thank you that you breathed it. You have filled it with your spirit. It's come from your very being. Thank you for the privilege that we have of having it in our own languages. The easy access that we have to it, which for so many people in our world today, they don't have it. But we have it. Father, help us to be people of your word. People who read your word, people who know your word, people who study your word, people who share your word with others. Thank you for the writer of this psalm that we've been looking at. Thank you for the challenge that is there from him to us. Help us to be people who live that out in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.